Now we pass on to section 25. Confession to a police officer not to be proved. No confession made to a police officer shall be proved as against a person accused of any offence. See, again, accused of any offence. But the same principle will apply. He need not then be accused of an offence. It is enough if he is subsequently accused of an offence. So, person accused of an offence in occurring in section 25 also is only descriptive of his subsequent status. Subsequent status. This section renders irrelevant any confession made to a police officer and declares that no confession made to a police officer shall be proved as against proved against a person accused of any offence. First question 1. Does a confession in a letter addressed to a police officer who is not physically present while writing the letter attract section 25? Confession made in a letter to the police officer who is not physically present there, does it attract section 25?
If it is in furtherance of
So nothing like that. Any because section 25 puts a complete bar to any confession made to
a police officer. The law contemplates that police officer should be physically present. Because that element of fear will not be there if a letter is sent to the police officer. Unless there is some duress practiced on him. Therefore, Supreme Court says it's not attracted. Section 25 is not attracted. AR 1966 Supreme Court 1906, Sitaram versus State of UP. Question 2. Is the following proposition of law true or false? Section 25 covers a confession made to a police officer before the commencement of investigation or made otherwise than in the course of investigation. It's a classic observation made by the Privy Council.
Section 25 covers a confession made to a police officer before the commencement of investigation or made otherwise than in the course of investigation, not during the investigation. What is the wording of section 25? No confession made to a police officer shall be proved as against a person accused of an offence. That's all.
But interpreting this section, the Privy Council in Pakkala Narayana Swami, again, I told you that we will have occasion to refer to this judgment. Lord Atkin, one of the greatest law lords, 5 law lords were there, rendered by Lord Atkin. Pakkala Narayana Swami vs. Emperor, AR 1939, Privy Council 47, held that section 25 covers a confession made to a police officer either before the commencement of investigation or otherwise than in the course of investigation. This proposition was true when it was made because subsection 2 to section 162 was not there. In the code, old code as well as new code, it was there. In the old code, this was rendered when the old code, old CRPC was in vogue. Subsection 2 of section 162 was not there. It was subsequent insertion of subsection 2 which made section 27 and applicable to, exempted from the purview of section 162 from the interdict under section 162(1). Therefore, this observation made by Pakkala Narayana Swami in 1939 was a valid observation when it was made, but it is no more valid after the insertion of subsection 2 to section 162 CRPC. In fact, in one of my articles I raised this question for the public, for the legal, for the forensic experts in our country to answer. Nobody responded except one senior advocate of Ernakulam, senior lawyer. He is not yet designated as senior advocate. He has almost stopped practice. One Jagdish Chandran Nair, he wrote an article. He correctly answered my question by saying that this is because at the time when the Privy Council decided Pakkala Narayana Swami, subsection 2 of section 162 was not there. Question 3. A person who is subsequently made an accused on a charge of uxoricide and who is not in custody tells a police officer that the charred body of his wife is lying in the rear courtyard of his house. Can the above statement be proved against him? What do you mean by uxoricide?
Killing of one's wife.
One's wife. What do you mean by homicide?
Killing of a human being.
Killing of a human being. Supposing I die due to, I am bitten by a snake, I die. Is it homicide?
So both the parties.
Killing of a human being by another human being is homicide. What is the one word for killing one's father?
Murder.
Patricide, right. Mother? Matricide. Parents? Parenticide. Then sister? Sororicide. Then infant? Infanticide. One's own child. Prolicide. Husband? Maritricide. Wife? Uxoricide. Then oneself? Killing oneself?
Suicide.
Then killing one's own, one's close relatives? Killing one's close relatives? Parricide. P-A-R-R-I. Killing of a woman? Gynecide. Gynecium. You must have, those of you who have learned botany, andricium, gynecium, gynecide. Or femicide. Then killing of a friend, amicide, amiable, all those derivatives are there. Killing of a friend, amicide. Then killing of an old man, senicide. Then killing of an entire race or tribe, genocide, absolutely right. Killing of a king or queen, regicide. Victoria Regina, regicide. Prophet, killing of a prophet, vaticide, Vatican, derived from Vatican, prophet. Then killing of one's own master or lord, dominicide, who is in a position to dominate, dominicide. Then killing of one's guest, hospiticide. Killing of a bishop, episcopicide, killing of a bishop. Then have you seen God? You have not seen God? But there is a one word for killing God. Decide. Deity. D-E-I-C-I-D. Decide. So we are on uxoricide. A person who is subsequently made an accused on a charge of uxoricide and who is not in custody tells the police officer that the charred body of his wife is lying in the rear courtyard of his house. Does it not attract Section 25 of the Evidence Act? My wife's charred body is lying in the rear courtyard of my house. He tells the police officer. Does it not attract Section 25? Uxoricide. Who is charged for uxoricide subsequently?
Sir, as far as the statement is concerned, it itself does not amount to any confession. So,
you are absolutely right. The statement, what does it say? What does he say? The charred body of my wife is lying in the courtyard of my house. Supposing his statement were, I had poured kerosene on the body of my wife and I had set her ablaze. Her charred body is lying in my courtyard. It would have involved a confession. But here it is only an admission. So you have to know the distinction between confession and admission. It is only an admission, not a confession. Pakkal Narayan Swami have we already referred to. Then it was affirmed by the Supreme Court or followed by the Supreme Court in Palvinder Kaur versus State of Punjab. AR 1952 Supreme Court 354. Ever so many decisions of the Supreme Court following Pakkal Narayan Swami. Question 4. A confession is made to a police constable who is neither discharging any police duty nor investigating the case. Is it hit by Section 25 of the Evidence Act? A police constable who is not discharging any police duty, he is not conducting any investigation also. A confession is made to him. Suppose he is posted in a particular place. Or I will give you another example. A police officer, an IPS or police officer, he is posted as the managing director of the Kerala State Road Transport Corporation. He is a police officer, IPS officer. But he is functioning as the managing director of the Kerala State Road Transport Corporation. A confession is made to him. He is not doing any police duty. He is not conducting any investigation. Is the confession hit by Section 25? You are absolutely right. He is a police officer. He is a police officer, rank and file. Therefore, a confession made to him, he is hit by Section 25. Supreme Court has gone to the extent of saying that he, whatever may be his rank,
if a confession is made to any member of a police force, any member of the police force, it is hit by Section 25. State of Punjab versus Barkat Ram, AR 1962, Supreme Court 3276.
Three judges. again affirmed in a constitutional bench in Ilias versus Collector of Customs, year 1970, Supreme Court, 1065, five judges. Question 5. In a murder case, the police have prepared a panchanama, mahzar, incorporating the confession of crime and signed not only by the panchas but also by the accused persons. Is not the court entitled to use the panchanama against the accused persons? Panchanama prepared by the police containing a written confession by the accused persons. It is got signed by the panchas as well as the witnesses as well as the accused. Can it not be used against the accused? Confession made to a police officer, prepared by a police officer. Self-incrimination, is it not?
Yes, sir.
It offends section 25 of the Evidence Act.
Yes.
And also 162 and 163, because he is a police officer conducting an investigation. No statement made by any person acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case to a police officer during the course of investigation shall be proved, admitted, gone into, looked into by the court because of the embargo under section 162 and CRPC. So both under section 25 as well as 162, it is tabooed, cannot be looked into. The year 1957, Supreme Court, 237. Question 6. Is the confessional statement of the accused which forms the basis of FIR inadmissible, and give your reasons? An accused makes a confession on the basis of which an FIR is registered. He is the first informant. He himself is the culprit. Is it admissible?
Sir, since it is made to a police officer in his presence, it is not...
Confession made to a police officer is tabooed under section 25. No confession made to a police officer. Is a confession made to a police officer? Is it not tabooed? Is it?
It is tabooed.
The confessional part of the statement is tabooed. But court can nevertheless look into the fact as to who set the criminal law in motion. Those things can be looked into. But the confessional part will be hit by section 25 of the Evidence Act. AR 1972, Supreme Court 922. But it can be looked into for the limited purpose of who the statement giver was. For that it can be looked into. But supposing that confession leads to a recovery under section 27. Supposing, apart from being the first informant, that confession also leads to a recovery under section 27.
Sir, then the part that leads to a recovery will be admissible, sir.
As for holding whether the officer concerned is a police officer or not. We have seen section 25. No confession made to a police officer. We have seen what the distinction between confession and admission. While all confessions are admissions, all admissions are not confessions. Therefore, now we have seen that part of the section. The other part, confession made to a police officer. Who is a police officer? Who is a police officer? So, to decide as to who is a police officer, some tests have been laid down by the Supreme Court. So, you have seen that confession made to a police officer is tabooed. Who is a police officer to whom a confession is tabooed? In Kerala, you must have seen the excise officers, forest officers. All of them wear khaki uniform. Is khaki uniform the decisive test for deciding whether a person is a police officer or not? Police officers wear khaki uniform. Forest officers wear khaki uniform. Excise officers khaki uniform. Are they police officers? Railway protection force, they also wear khaki uniform. A confession made to an RPF officer, is it or is it not tabooed? Who is a police officer? The very, very decisive test. And Supreme Court finally has, in the line of decisions of the Supreme Court, to hold that this officer whom you call a police officer should not only have the power to conduct an investigation under the CRPC, he should also have an additional power to file a final report under section 173(2) CRPC. Subsection 2 of section 173, final report. Charge sheet, challan. He should have the power to file a final report under section which we call in the CRPC police report. What is defined in the CRPC is only police report. So he is that officer who has got not only the power to conduct investigation, but also the power to file a final report under Section 173 to CRPC.
Confession made to a constable.
Whether he is on police duty or not, I told you the 62 Supreme Court decision, 3 judges bench. Even if he is not doing any police duty, if he is a police officer, any confession made to him is tabooed under Section 25. Now here is a case where you have to decide whether the person to whom the confession is made is a police officer or not. How to decide that? Is there any blue litmus test to decide whether he is a police officer or not? Is there any test? Supreme Court has laid down the test in ever so many decisions that he is a police officer who has got the power, authority to conduct an investigation under the CRPC, and not only that, he should have the further power, further authority to file a final report under Section 173 to CRPC. Then only he becomes a police officer. I will soon demonstrate that this test laid down by Supreme Court is wrong. With due respect, I will demonstrate. Now the citations are, of course, these decisions, especially by two constitution bench rulings, they are all binding on you and me. So until and unless those decisions are overruled, and so long as they hold the field, both of us are bound by the rulings of the Supreme Court by virtue of the power under Article 141 of the Constitution of India. Binding law laid down by the Supreme Court is binding on all courts and authorities, tribunals, everybody. But then it can be demonstrated that this test laid down by the Supreme Court may not work in all situations. I'll show that. Now the citations are AR 1966 Supreme Court 1746, 5 judges. Again, AR 1970 Supreme Court 1065, again 5 judges, Constitution Bench. Then AR 1981 Supreme Court 379, AR 1991 Supreme Court 45. There are ever so many decisions to the effect that the officer should not only have the power to conduct investigation under the CRPC, but should also have the power to file a final report after the conclusion of investigation. Next question. Is confession made to an excise inspector who is deemed to be an officer in charge of a police station under the Bihar and Orissa Excise Act 1915, hit by Section 25? No, sir. He is deemed to be a police officer. He is an excise inspector under the Bihar Act. He is deemed to be a police officer for the purpose of investigation. That way you may come across Customs Act and NDPS Act also. Non-police officers are invested with the powers of an officer in charge of a police station. Such non-police officers are invested with the powers in charge of a police station. Every one of you should read this particular decision, that is Directorate of Enforcement versus Deepak Mahajan, AR 1994 Supreme Court 1775, wherein Supreme Court has enumerated various statutes under which non-police officers are invested with the powers of an officer in charge of a police station for the purpose of investigation. Supreme Court very rightly said, by that investiture of power, they don't become police officers. They are only given the powers of an officer in charge of a police station for conducting investigation. By that alone, they don't become police officers. Therefore, you don't call a customs officer a police officer. You don't call a railway protection force officer, the member of the railway protection force, a police officer, because they don't have the power to conduct investigation under the CRPC, and they don't also have the power to file a final report under Section 173 to CRPC. But in this case, Supreme Court merely said that since they are invested with the powers of an officer in charge of a police station, they are police officers. According to me, not very correct. Question 9. Does the interdict under Section 25 apply to a confession made before a customs officer under Section 108 of the Customs Act 1962? Section 108 of the Customs Act gives the officer a power to conduct inquiry under the Customs Act in respect of offenders who have been nabbed for caught for committing offences under the Customs Act. Now, Supreme Court has very categorically held that they are not police officers. They don't have the power to conduct investigation under CRPC, nor do they have the power to file a final report. Therefore, they are not police officers, and therefore, any confession made to them will not be hit by Section 25 of the Evidence Act. State of Punjab versus Barkat Ram, AR 1962, Supreme Court 276, which I have referred to already. Then AR 1970, Supreme Court 1065, again Constitution Bench, 5 judges. Ram Singh versus Central Bureau of Narcotics, AR 2011, Supreme Court 2490. So, mind you, a non-police officer merely exercising police powers for the purpose of investigation will not make him a police officer unless he is also given the power to file a final report under Section 173 to CRPC. Question 10 is a very important question. Is confession made to an Abkari officer under the Kerala Abkari Act 1077 ME hit by Section 25 of the Evidence Act? See, until 3/6/1997, Abkari officers or excise officers under the Kerala Abkari Act were filing complaints under Section 50, and magistrate had the jurisdiction to take cognizance only on a complaint, not on a police report. But with effect from 3/6/1997, this act was amended by the state legislature, including among the excise officers, police officers also. And Section 50 was also amended to incorporate subsection 2, whereby it was worded, all excise officers under this act conducting an investigation shall do so under Chapter 12 of the CRPC. They shall conduct investigation under Chapter 12 of CRPC, and after conclusion of investigation, they shall file a final report under Section 173 to CRPC. In the case of police officers, okay, but there are non-police excise officers who are also conducting investigation under this act. They were made police officers by applying the test of Supreme Court. So, who is a police officer? He is a police officer who is entitled to conduct investigation and file a final report. 50 subsection 2 says an Abkari officer after investigation shall file a final report after the conclusion of investigation. So, a non-police officer was made a police officer. If the test laid down by the Supreme Court is correct, then how can a non-police officer become a police officer just because he is invested with the power of an officer in charge of a police station and also to file a final report? And do you mean to say that customs officers don't exert any duress, don't exert any threat, inducement or promise while recording statements? They do exert. Likewise, non-police officers, so many officers under various statutes. NDPS Act also not only takes in police officers, Narcotic Control Bureau, they are not police officers. They also exert all these methods for extracting a confession. See the paradox. NDPS Act, police officer acting under the NDPS Act, confession made to him is tabooed. But a Narcotic Control Bureau officer, under the very same statute, if a confession is made to him, is not tabooed. Very same act, very same offence, but two agencies. One is police, other is non-police. Now, that is why in 2009, Kerala High Court was tempted to hold that after 3/6/1997, in the case of Kerala Abkari Act, an Abkari officer has become a police officer and any confession made to him will be hit by Section 25 of the Evidence Act. The citation is 2009 4KHC Kerala High Court cases 537. Because we are all bound by the catena of decisions of the Supreme Court, which says this is the test to be applied for finding out whether an officer is a police officer or not. Therefore, applying this test, a non-police officer becomes a police officer. Now, I will give you another diametrically opposite position. Question 11. Is confession made to a police officer who, by virtue of Section 22 of the Transplantation of Human Organs Act 1994, TOHO Act for short,
statutorily prohibited from filing a final report, police report under section 173(2) CRPC, admissible. See, under the Transplantation of Human Organs Act, section 22 says, a police officer conducting an investigation shall file a complaint, and court can take cognizance only on a complaint, not on a police report. He is statutorily debarred from filing a police report. So here is a case where he is undoubtedly a police officer, station house officer, an officer in charge of the police station, conducting an investigation as per CRPC. But finally, he can only file a complaint. So you apply the test later on by Supreme Court, he cannot file a final report under 173(2). Therefore, he is not a police officer. See the paradox. See, a police officer to begin with, and by all definitions, he is a police officer. He does not become a police officer for the purpose of section 25 because we apply the test laid down by the Supreme Court. But anyway, until the Supreme Court overrules its own constitution bench rulings, we are all bound by that. Question 12. Is not the accused entitled to take shelter under section 25 of the Evidence Act to plead that the police officer cannot take a confession statement from him? Investigation is going on. Police officer is about to record his confession statement. Accused files a petition or a writ petition before the High Court saying that here is an investigating officer who is about to go take a confession statement. A confession made to the police officer is hereby section 25. Why should he record my confession at all? Please prevent him from recording my confession. Section law says a confession made to a police officer shall not be used against him. So why should here is an investigating officer who is about to record my confession. Don't allow him to do that.
Confession anyway is not admissible.
It's not admissible. Then why should he record my confession? Why is he so insistent that I should confess? So I go to the High Court. I file a writ petition. Ask the High Court to stop him from recording my confession. I don't want to confess anything. I am not in a mood to confess. And even if I confess, it is not admissible against me by virtue of section 25. So, exercise in futility, an illegal exercise by the investigating officer. Please prevent him from doing that. What do you say?
So, making the confession statement is up to the accused himself. So,
pardon?
Making of a confessional statement,
yes,
is up to the accused himself.
So, even if he voluntarily, there is no compulsion. Article 23, no person shall be compelled to be a witness against himself. But here there is no compulsion. Even if he voluntarily makes a confession, not admissible. Any confession made to a police officer, whether voluntarily or involuntarily, is hit by 25.
Sir, but sometimes it may happen that in the confessional statement,
There
might be possibility of discovery of a new fact. So, such a statement is admissible under the Indian Evidence Act.
You are almost near the truth.
So, in
yes,
the
because trial, see, maybe it is not admissible before a court of law, but this is only at the stage of investigation. You can't prevent the investigating officer from questioning you, because an accused person is also a person acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case within the meaning of section 161(1). 161(1) says any police officer conducting an investigation may orally examine any person acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case. That includes an accused person also. He is acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case. Or rather, he is the only person who is more acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case. Therefore, you can't prevent an investigating officer from questioning an accused person. Of course, during the course of questioning, if he records a confession, well and good, it may not be admissible. A police officer may not be a source for conviction. It is a source of information to put the criminal law into motion. It is definitely a source of information for the investigating officer. Take for example, test identification parade or sniffer dog. You are taking a sniffer dog into the several houses. Sniffer dog goes into several places and catches at the culprit. Is it evidence under the Evidence Act? It is not evidence. But then, it assures the investigating officer that he is investigating on proper lines. He is investigating on proper lines. Likewise, test identification parade. why should the, what is the requirement of conducting a test identification parade? Why do the police conduct a test identification parade? Culprit is not known to the victim. He has no previous acquaintance with the culprit. Victim has no previous acquaintance with the culprit. Or an eyewitness does not have previous acquaintance with the culprit. He is seeing the culprit only at the time of occurrence. No previous acquaintance. So, he will have to be doubly sure. The investigating officer will have to be doubly sure that he is proceeding in the proper lines. He is proceeding against the proper person. He has already caught a person as the accused. He wants to assure himself that he is the person. So, he conducts a test identification parade, which is not substantive evidence in the eye of law. Test identification parade is not substantive evidence. What is substantive evidence in the eye of law is the doc identification by the victim or the witness in the court. That is substantive evidence. I identify the accused in the dock, standing in the dock. That is substantive evidence. But my identification during test identification period is not substantive evidence. It only corroborates the evidence, the substantive evidence given in court. Therefore, if the police conducts a test identification period, TIP for short, it is not for collecting evidence, but to assure himself that he is proceeding on proper lines. Likewise, this interrogating the accused and extracting a confession may not be admissible in evidence, but it certainly instructs the investigating officer that he is proceeding on proper lines. He has got at the proper culprit, the right culprit. All these things are relevant for investigation, though not, it may not be evidence. It may not stand the scrutiny of a court of law. The citation is AR 2015 Supreme Court 2050. 2050. Question 13. Is confession made in police custody obtained under an illegal order of remand admissible? Confession obtained under an illegal order of remand. He is remanded illegally and a confession is obtained. Is it admissible? Whatever may be the illegality in the remand order, if the confession has been obtained, that is admissible in evidence. The parallel for this is, supposing the search and seizure is conducted illegally. Whatever be the illegality of the search and seizure, evidence obtained during the search and seizure is admissible. Supposing I conduct a house breaking, I burgle into somebody else's house and take a document and I produce it before court. It is procured illegally, even though the means of production is illegal. If the document is otherwise admissible, it can be looked into by the court. The illegality of the search or seizure will not vitiate the evidence of the search. Likewise, illegality of the remand will not affect the confession bit.
So, if we look at the same situation and compare...
And there is a constitutional major ruling also. Puranmal versus state of somebody. Puranmal is the citation. I don't remember the citation. It's a constitutional major ruling. They said whatever may be the illegality on the behind the search or seizure, once something is disclosed or seized from the illegal search or seizure, the matter seized is an item of evidence which can be looked into by the court. Yes, your
sir. If we look at it and compare it with the section 65B of the Evidence Act, which talks
65B.
Yes, sir, talks about admissibility of electronic evidence.
Yes.
Sir, there the Supreme Court has said that unless all the strict guidelines are met and complied with, it will not take in any evidence, no matter if the ends of justice are also not met.
Some criticism against that judgment also. And recently Supreme Court said if the, supposing it is in your mobile phone, if you are having the custody of the mobile phone, then the victim cannot be blamed for that. So recently Supreme Court said, even if it is available in the gadget of the accused, it can be looked into. Recently, one year ago, Supreme Court has gone beyond that Parliament attack case. Yes, Parliament attack case, they were very, subsequently that Justice Kurian Joseph and somebody else held that Anwar versus
Bashir.
Anwar versus Bashir, that has been watered down now, watered down. Well, let us hope that 65B will be given its due share. 14. It's not the word confession in Section 25 of the Evidence Act confined to confession of the offence which is under investigation. A confession is it not confined to the offence which is under investigation? Supposing some other offence is being investigated and some other accused is stumbled upon by the investigating officer and a confession is taken. Can it be taken in evidence? Can it be considered? It can be considered. Can be considered because you are only concerned about the confessional part. Very often in theft cases, the police come across an accused person while conducting the investigation of some other case. They may be investigating some other case. While so a person may come on his motorcycle. Motorcycle itself may be a stolen property. And he seizes the motorcycle, arrests the accused, takes a confession. That confession, which is not in respect of an offence under investigation, is also admissible in evidence. State versus NMT Joy Immaculate, AR 2004, Supreme Court 2282. Likewise, sting operation. A former judge of our High Court, Kerala High Court, was subjected to a sting operation. And some statements were extracted by the media and they were flashed in the media. Public were at loggerheads, or rather they were criticizing the judge like anything without the judges knowing. Judge said, we'll have some private discussion about a particular case. Judge was inviting them. They wanted the judge to invite them. Judge invited them after his retirement. In a private talk, of course, judge was a party to a judgment in which the accused were acquitted. In a very loose talk, they were having a discussion. This was, they told the judge that it's not being photographed, not being covered, but actually they were covering it by a spy camera. It was flashed in the media. People went against the judge. He was painted black, very black. Whatever may be the illegality, if the evidence obtained by the illegal search or seizure can be looked into by the court, notwithstanding the illegality in obtaining the evidence. Is not admission of a gravely incriminating fact, example, an admission that the accused is the owner and was in recent possession of the knife or revolver which caused the death, with no explanation of man's possession, a confession. Gravely incriminating fact about the possession of a weapon, etc. Mere possession of a weapon is not a confession. Narcotic drug, mere possession is an offence. But possession of a weapon may not be illegal. It may not amount to a confession of an offence. It is only an admission in terms of the offence that the rate substantially all the facts. So Pakkala Narayana Swami, you will have to remember the test laid down by Pakkala Narayana Swami. In order to become a confession, you should admit the offence or substantially the facts constituting the offence should be admitted. Then only the confession becomes a confession.